Bienvenue au séminaire Maxpo CVPOF CE, séminaire impromptu. Welcome to the Maxpo CVPOF CE impromptu seminar. We're very pleased to have today Thomas Piketty that will present his new work called Brahmin Left versus Merchant Right, Rising Inequality and the Changing Structure of Political Conflicts. So it's a work in progress. The working paper is already available. It might not be necessary to present Thomas Piketty. He's a worldwide famous economist. He's a director d'études à l'École des hautes études en sciences sociales. He published many articles and books, including Les hauts revenus en France au XXe siècle and Capital in the 21st Century. In his book, Capital in the 21st Century, he praised interdisciplinary research in social science with data and methods and ideas of economics with mixing with data, ideas, and methods in political science, in sociology, history, anthropology. And in fact, his book, that some said as being very descriptive, is the first step for new researchers. So establishing trans inequality is interesting because it enables us to understand other stuff, including political life. So now we come more to the theoretical part and the causal part on how those trends on inequality might matter also on political life, and building bridges with ongoing research in political science. And one of the thing I greatly admire in Thomas Piketty's work, both in his work on inequality and his new opus, is his capacity to standardize heterogeneity, and maybe that will be part of the discussion for today. So in order to discuss his contribution, we will have insights from three scholars in political science from Sciences Po. Martial Foucault is the director of the CVPOF. Nona Meyer is Emeritus Research Director at the Centre d'études européennes. And Yann Rovny is professor at the Centre d'études européennes. So Thomas, the floor is yours. But before starting his talk, he will make a little poll asking for people who are not fluent in French to raise their hands. And depending on the proportion, he will pick the language in which he will be comfortable to talk. And in the discussion, maybe there will be parts of the discussion that will be in English or in French. And in the Q&A, we are all fluent in both languages, so please be free to discuss, criticize, challenge in either languages. So who's non-French speaking in the room? Please raise your hand. So, Thomas, up to you. Not a big proportion, but the minority has some rights.
But the question was French speaking. The question is, can you understand French, which is a bit different. The slides will be in English. But is it, seriously, is it a big problem for, who is it a big problem for if I speak in French? Just tell me, you know. It's
don't be shy.
Don't be shy. You know, it's nice to speak in French from time to time, but you know, okay, there are sufficiently many people who don't like French, so let's go in English. My English sounds a lot like French, but still, it's, you know, I like it. So I'm gonna follow very much this presentation. I don't know if you guys want to stay there because maybe it would be better. Oh, I can speak. I can speak there. Yes, that's even better. Okay, so this is what I'm gonna present today. You know, first I will present a few results as general motivation from the World Inequality Report, but most of all, I will present this paper. So this is a working paper that's available online. So, you know, whatever I will not have time to present, just go online to this website or go to the other website for the World Inequality Report, and you will have all the materials that I will be presenting today. So what this paper, you know, Brahmin Left versus Merchant Right is doing, so Olivier was saying, well, this is the theoretical part after the Capital in the 21st century. I'm not so sure. I think it's still pretty much a descriptive part. And you know, what I'm trying to do in this work is to try to describe what can be said about the evolution of the structure of the electorate of people voting for different group of parties, which you can call left or right if you want. But in the end, the main result of the paper is that in these three countries, France, US, Britain, you have such a huge, complete transformation of the structure of the electorate voting for left and right over the past half a century that, you know, calling them with the same names throughout is a strange choice in a way, because, well, the purpose of this research is to deconstruct the notion of left and right and to better understand. You know, we all feel that things have changed a lot since the 50s, 60s about who's voting for whom. And here I want to make clear about, you know, what we can know in common about how much this has changed. So it's not that we didn't know anything about this before, but I think this is the first time that homogeneous series of voting structure by income, education, and wealth have been put together over such a long period of time for these three countries. Now, a lot of work, of course, has already been done in this area. You know, Martial has worked a lot on voting pattern by wealth. You know, many people... Look, I'm not going to claim that this is the first time people look at this, but putting such long-run series over this long period for these three countries, I think, was not done before. And I find pretty striking result, in particular, showing, you know, what I will call, you know, the shift from a class-based political conflict to a multiple elite political conflict. And I will be clearer about what I mean by this. And I will argue that this change in the cleavage structure can help explain the lack of political response to rising inequality. But of course, that's only a possible interpretation, and there's no way I'm going to prove that today. Okay, so all I'm going to do today is pretty much, you know, descriptive. I'm going to describe the evolution of the electorate for different parties and coalition of parties for these three countries. And then, you know, it's up to you for the interpretation. You know, I don't pretend I have the right one. You know, it's okay if you disagree. You know, it's just, I'm going to just try to put on the table this data, and then, you know, I have my own interpretation, but I don't pretend this is the right one, and I'm certainly not able to prove it at this stage. I should also mention that this particular working paper is part of a book that I am now writing, now completing in the coming months, and that will be out next September. And so it's very useful for me to get feedback, to get reactions, to get comments. But I should say, you know, the book includes a lot of material on actually the policies that have been conducted by these different parties, which is not something I'm going to talk about today. So by choice, today, we are only going to talk about who's voting for which parties. Now, of course, the reason why this is changing over time presumably has something to do with the policies. You know, if the low education don't vote for the left anymore, well, maybe because they perceive that the left is not really promoting their interest in one way or another. And you know, maybe they don't understand. But if nobody understands for half a century in all countries, you know, maybe there's a problem with the sender of the message as much as with the receiver of the message. So, but, I'm, you know, I'm not going to talk about the policy content today. This is something I talk a lot more in the book as we come out in September. But here, I'm really going to focus on the structure of the electorate. And, you know, we'll see in the discussion how much we talk about the policy content, which, of course, we all care deeply about, but that's not the... Today, you know, what do we know about the structure of the electorate? This is the most, you know, simplest question, but I think still important and interesting. Okay, so I'm going to go very quickly through a number of graphs of the World Inequality Report just to illustrate the rise in inequality and then move right away to the... prime and left. So let me go really very fast. So this is the evolution of the top 10% income share in a number of areas in the world. You see you have rising inequality pretty much in all areas of the world. You know, it's not as strong in Europe as in the US. It's not as strong in China as in India. It's huge in Russia, partly for artificial reason, because you come from a very compressed structure of monetary inequality, which doesn't mean there was not other forms of inequalities, and, you know, money is not everything. So anyway, that's just the general picture for rising inequality. If you put this in a longer time perspective for US, Europe, Japan, well, it is an average for Western Europe, You can see that the rise of inequality in recent decades come after a long period of stabilization of relatively lower level of inequality between 1950 and 1980, which itself came after a huge decline during the first half of the century. So this is the story I tell in my book, Capital in the 21st Century, so I'm not going to tell it again. But you know, you have a large number of political shock, and you know, basically the transformation from pre-1914 society based on property and very strong consumption of private property into a more social democratic regime, if you want, in the 1950-1980 period with nationalization, welfare state, progressive taxation, you know, everything you want. So that, you know, this corresponds to a huge transformation. But then, you know, one of the big questions is why do we have this rise in inequality at the end of the period? So some people say, well, that's globalization. Okay, but globalization also happened in Japan, in Sweden, in Germany, not only in the US. So that's not going to be enough. You also need to talk about why different political systems generate different policy packages which lead to different level of rise in inequality. So certainly taxation is an important part of the story. You know, the US used to have, and the UK used to have, the most progressive income tax system in the world, you know, with top income tax rate of 90% between 1930 and 1980. You know, after the 1980s, they've become the least progressive. So this can have lots of impact on the top pay formation, on the, you know, accumulation of high wealth. You know, this can have a lot of impact, including on pre-tax inequality, and not only on after-tax inequality. You have the same evolution for the taxation of inheritance, which has been incredibly progressive, particularly in US, UK, more than in Germany, France. But in Germany, France, of course, there was a lot of destruction and inflation in the middle of the century, so there was less of a need, in a way, for huge progressive taxation. So now taxation is important, but you know, that's not the only policy that matters. If you want to explain the collapse in the bottom 50% income in the US, you know, the decline of progressive taxation at the top is not going to be enough. You want to talk about the minimum wage. You want to talk about a decline of union. You want to talk about unequal access to education. So this is, you know, as a function of percentile income rank for the parents, your probability to go to college in the US. So this is right now. This was the people in college 2012-2015. So, you know, it's almost a 45-degree line. You almost go from 0 to 100%, not quite, but you know. So you know, you have the theory of meritocracy and equal opportunity, and you have the reality of the policies and the educational system which we have, which can be quite different. So that can contribute to explain the collapse of bottom incomes in the US as compared to the rise at the top. And there are many other policies, you know, which I cannot talk about. The decline of public wealth. So you see, this is a share of net public wealth, net national wealth. You see, when I wrote my book, 2012, the only Western country with negative public wealth was Italy. Now we have US and the UK. So what does it mean, negative public wealth? It means you have more public debt than public assets, as they are recorded by the official National Statistical Institute, which is not perfect, but at least this says something. This means that even if you sell all your public buildings, public sovereign fund, if you have one, whatever public assets that can be sold according to the official national accounts, this will not be enough to reimburse the total public debt. So this, you know, this could get more negative. This means when it gets more negative, it means that private wealth owners own not only every public asset there is to own through their financial claim, but also some additional claims on taxpayer money for the future, basically. So it can get very negative if necessary. This has already happened in the past. But of course, this means a lot of power for whoever owns this claim, because you know, we are not being owned by the Mars planet. You know, this is all private wealth owners in the end. So you know, I'm not saying it's interesting to see that in China, this has stabilized after the 2008 to about 30%, which is the average of about 50% in the corporate sector and close to zero in the housing sector. So, you know, national wealth sort of half corporate and half housing. Now, I'm not saying 30% is the right number. It's comparable to what we had in the mixed economy period of the 1950-1990, 20-30%, you know, very low public debt, quite a lot of public assets. Now, with the privatization of public assets and the rise of public debt, you get to negative. Okay, I don't know what's the optimum, but you know, negative is really small, and so if it gets more negative, so anyway, that's part of the general evolution. So yeah, it's more evolution about nationalization, public debt, and the property regime, broadly speaking. Okay, so there are many different areas of policy that have changed. Now, the question is, why is rising inequality not leading to rising demand for redistribution? And this is where we get to the structure of voting. You know, should you expect, you know, in a very naive median voter model with rising inequality, you know, the median voter becoming poorer as compared to the average, taking more money from the rich, and therefore you should have a rise in redistribution? Well, the real world seems to be a lot more complicated than this, partly because it's a multidimensional world. You know, inequality of what? Is it inequality of education, inequality of property, inequality of income, inequality of gender, of racial attributes, of age, or whatever? And this multidimensionality of inequality is what makes redistribution complicated. It's also what makes life interesting and politics interesting in a way, because, you know, the world is not one-dimensional. And so this is what I'm going to look at. Okay, so, you know, you have some stories, of course, in the background that globalization and competition have made vertical redistribution more complicated and therefore have exacerbated identity conflict. You know, take the extreme case where you believe national governments are not able to do any vertical redistribution anymore, and the only thing they control is basically border control. You know, that's the only thing they control. Then, of course, the entire political conflict is going to be about border control and who can enter the country, migration. And so I don't think we are in this world, but clearly, if you tend to, you know, you have an evolution, or at least the perception is that you can do less and less class-based vertical redistribution. And it's not surprising that the policy conflict is going to focus more on other issues, typically migration. Now, I think it's part of what's going on, but it's still too simplistic. And so in this research, okay, I'm going to go a bit fast. What I do in this research to try to understand better this question is I'm going to really try to construct. So the main contribution is going to be, as I said before, very much descriptive, empirical, historical. You know, I'm going to construct long-run series on the changing structure of the electorate. So by this, I mean that, you know, I want to know who votes for which parties depending on different dimensions of inequality, in particular income, wealth, and education will be the three I mentioned, but I will also look at origins, religion, which, of course, is measured in a, it's a very tricky issue. It's measured in very different ways by construction in different countries, particularly in the US and Europe. So there are really two ways in general you can do that. One is by using post-electoral survey. You can also use local level election results matched with census other data, which the good thing is that you can go back in time to, you know, whenever elections started to exist. Basically, you have local level election data and you have some form of census or administrative data. But it's more complicated because it's going to be indirect in order to recover the individual impact of individual characteristic on voting. With post-electoral surveys, the good thing is that you directly ask people, okay, what's your income, what's your education, how did you vote? So in principle, you can see directly who's voting for whom. So that's what I'm going to do in this research. The one reason for looking at France, US, Britain is that you have pretty good post-electoral surveys starting in the 1948 for the US, 1950s for France and Britain. So and it's very important to be able to look at the 50s, 60s, you know, which is sort of the golden age, social democratic period, if you want to see where we start from. If you start from the 1980s, that's not going to work because it's already things have already changed a lot. So it's quite important to be able to start right after the war. So this work is currently being extended to many other countries, and I can talk more about the findings if some of you ask me, but today I will really only present these three countries. There's a theoretical model of two-dimensional competition also in the paper for those of you who are interested, but I don't think I'm going to really present this today. I'm going to stick to the empirical results. Although, you know, I think a simple model sometimes can be useful, but still less interesting than the data, I think. So let's look at the data. So the main empirical finding will be this rise of multiple elite politics. So basically, what we're going to find is that in the 50s, 60s, the vote for left-wing, so to speak, so which will be the Labour Party in Britain, the Democratic Party in the US, and the combination of Socialist Communist Party in France, was a sort of class-based vote in the sense that this vote for this group of parties was systematically associated with lower education, lower income, lower wealth. So you take any of the different dimensions of social inequality when you are at the bottom, you vote more for these parties. And this is cumulative. So if you are at the bottom in all of these dimensions, you vote even more. And if you are at the top in all the dimensions, you vote even less. Okay, so that's what you can label a class-based conflict in the sense that whatever the dimension of class, it will be aligned. You have an alignment of the different dimensions, which can seem obvious, but in fact, there's no deep reason why it should be like that in the end. I mean, it was like that, but it's for particular historical reasons that it was like that. Maybe there was, because there was a policy platform, call it social security, welfare state, whatever, which sort of made different people stick together coming from different backgrounds and different regions, rural areas, urban areas, low education, a bit higher education, but all with low, relatively low income. But anyway, there was some reasons that made this stand, the shock due to World War I, World War II, the Great Depression, had made, reduced the faith in economic market and laissez-faire policy a lot. So I mean, there were lots of reasons where you had this structure of the political conflict. Now, what I will argue is that in these three countries, this has changed gradually, and the vote for these same parties has gradually become associated since the 1970s, 80s, so this starts really very early on, with higher education voters, so that since the 1990s, 2000, you have a sort of multiple elite, what I call a multiple elite party system, where the high education elite tend to vote for the left, whereas high income and especially high wealth elite, so if you have a Manoir and you are Fillon, you still vote for the right. And if you are a PhD, you vote for Hollande or Hillary Clinton. So that's you have an intellectual elite versus business elite. I call it business elite. It's more complicated. But anyway, you have different dimensions, one more related to education, one more related to property and business activities, which one gives one type of vote and party and coalition and the other type. Now, if you are at the top in both dimensions, sometimes you can be a bit lost and you have to decide which way to go, but it's not perfectly correlated. Now, what I will argue is that this multiple elite party system can explain why redistributive issues have become less central, can also explain why, to some extent, other groups might feel left behind. So if you are at the bottom everywhere, maybe you don't feel that anybody really cares about you, at least it's a possible interpretation. But in any case, here I really want to show you a lot of graphs documenting this evolution. I think this is a very deep evolution. This corresponds to what you can call a complete decomposition of the post-war left versus right party system, which opens up for many possibilities in the future. But to begin with today, I just try to make you realize that you have these three countries with very different party systems to begin with. The Democratic Party in the US has nothing to do with the Socialist or Communist Party in France. Historically, it was the party of slavery, then become party of the New Deal, then become the party of Obama. Completely different trajectory from the European Labour or Socialist Party. And the fact that you have this evolution that has a lot in common, I think, is important, because very often when we look at this, people in the US, as tend to be US-centered and don't care too much about the rest of the world, and so they don't look at Europe. But also people in Europe tend to feel that the US, is so different with racial inequality, they still don't understand how the party of slavery became the party of the New Deal, and they think this is really a very weird country, and what's happened. And so they don't necessarily make the comparison. And when we look at the populist right, populist left, whatever, in Europe, so I think just putting these three countries together, trying to show what's in common in this evolution is already interesting. So this is the kind of graph I will show you a lot. So this is just one example. So this is the vote for Socialist, Communist, Green Party in France. And this is the difference between how many people vote for these parties among university graduates minus how many vote for these parties among non-university graduates. So when it's negative, it means that university graduates used to vote more for the right. And it becomes positive, it means that now they vote more for the left. Okay? So you have this evolution, which is pretty strong. Now, what's interesting is that it's still true after controls. I will show you this later. It's very close to what you get for the US. It's really incredibly close. It's also quite close to what you get for Britain, with the Labour Party. Probably the best way to put the data is this last one, where instead, so the difference is that here I look at university graduate versus non-university graduate. Here I look at the top 10% education versus bottom 90%. So I adjust for the fact that the fraction of university graduate, of course, has changed a lot over time. I think this way to look at the data is a bit more meaningful, because, and in fact, it makes the evolution even a bit stronger at the end, because at the end of the period where you have maybe 30% of the population with higher education in the US, the higher you are in higher education, the even more you vote for the Democrats, whereas the opposite was true. You know, the higher you are, you will vote for the Republican at the beginning of the period. So, yeah, and I think it's a bit more meaningful way to slice the data, but no matter how you slice the data and you make this decomposition, you will get this evolution. You can see that Britain is sort of lagging behind France and US a little bit. So Britain is like, 20 years later, if you want the French or US evolution, which I think has to have to do with the fact that the Labour Party is a much more, lower class based party to begin with. Remember Keynes, in the interwar period, said that he would never vote for the Labour Party because these were barbarians with no good economists, and that the Liberal Party will always be the party of social progress. You know, he has this famous speech in the interwar period when he says that. Now, of course, he dies in 1946, I guess. So just at the time, the Liberal Party is about to disappear, and probably he would have started to vote Labour had he lived 10 years or 20 years more, and he would have become a good Labour Bremen advisor. But it took time in the US, in the UK, for the sort of educated elite to move to the Labour. But in the end, the evolution, what's interesting is that, you have some meaningful differences across these countries, but you also have some commonalities which we want to understand. Okay, so I'm going to start with the French results and show you the data in more detail for France. Then we move to the US and to the UK. Then we talk about a number of open questions. Someone is going to tell me when we have, or is there a time somewhere? No. Oh yes, there is a time. Okay. So we should stop at around 6. Or yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Good. Okay. So this is what we are going to do. So let's start with the French. So there's a long tradition of post-sexual survey in France, so this is really the place to talk about that, because many of these surveys have been organized by CEVIPOF since the 1960s, actually. So it's a very long story, which many of you here have been involved with a lot. And I want to say thank you to the CEVIPOF for organizing this survey for so long, because this is the raw materials that I've been using, and without the documentation and all the hard work, starting very early. In particular, what I will argue is that something really good about the French tradition of post-electoral survey, which was partly invented in the famous 1978 post-electoral survey, was to ask questions on asset ownership, which, as I will show, matters a lot. And unfortunately, we don't have it in the US. So it's not that wealth does not matter in the US. I think it will matter as well. And when we have a little bit of data on asset ownership, it very much seems to be like for France. But usually, you don't have it in the post-electoral survey. In Britain, it's a sort of intermediate situation. There are some questions about asset ownership. I mean, you always have a question about housing ownership, including in the US. In Britain, you also have some questions about from time to time, for instance, when you privatize companies under Thatcher, you start to have questions about do you own shares in privatized companies, etc. You have questions about do you have a mortgage? So just by doing some simple wealth indicator, do you have a house with no mortgage, house with a mortgage, do you have share in privatized companies? You construct this simple wealth index. It works very well in the same direction as for France. But it's less detailed than in France, where you have more detailed asset ownership questions. Do you have stock? Do you have bonds? Do you have, do you own your company? So, and I think it's very important. Now, the size of this survey is limited. So please have in mind that many of the year-to-year or election-to-election variation I'm going to show you are not meaningful. The long-run evolution is meaningful, and I will show you some confidence interval to show you that the long-run evolution is meaningful. But please don't lose time trying to interpret the difference between the 1967 election and 1965 or whatever, because that's not the kind of data you can use for that. Okay? You will need to use other data, local-level election data matched with census data, which is more complicated to use to recover the individual voting pattern. But in any case, don't try to do it with this because you have standard errors that are meaningful. Okay, so so I had a lot of fun using this survey, in particular the earlier one, 1958, 1962, 65, which are really in a very bad shape, but this is what makes it nice because the question and the variables are not very well preserved, but at the end you still get, I think, interesting stuff if you spend sufficient time with them, which is what I like to do, so it happens to be the case that I like this kind of work. You know, sorry for the strange passion, but I know many of you in the room share this strange passion. Okay, so I'm going to use both presidential election and legislative election. Legislative election, I think, more interesting in a way because also they are more representative of the complexity of the French party system, and also they have been there for a much longer period. You can go back to the Third Republic. But I will. You get the same results, basically, the same pattern, same broad pattern for the presidential vote and the legislative vote. So these are the presidential vote I will look at. These are second round presidential vote, excluding the vote with the extreme right, which we can talk about, but it's a very expected. What you get is very much what we already know. There's nothing really surprising. So here I really look at all these closed election race in the second round, De Gaulle, Mitterrand to Hollande, Sarkozy. This is for the legislative election. So I'm going to put all socialists, communists, green, extreme left in the left, all center right, extreme right in the right. It's not that I believe that these are meaningful government coalition. The only reason for doing that is because I'm going to compare to Britain and the US, where you have a reasonably well-defined two-party system. And so I think to make this comparison, it's meaningful. I mean, in the Conservative Party in Britain, you also have different factions. You have more anti-immigration faction. You have less anti-immigration factions. The same is true in the Republican Party. It takes a different institutional form in the US and UK, but it doesn't mean that everybody agrees it's one of the two big parties. So here we are going to forget about all these important differences within the left and within the right, which, of course, we all care a lot about. But we are going to forget about it. And we're gonna focus on these two coalitions so that this can be compared to Democratic versus Republican vote in the US or Labour versus Conservative vote in the UK. So the Modem vote, which was LRM vote, Modem vote, which was 32% in 2017, and this graph has been split into two halves, which, you know, there are many different ways to split it, and I leave it to your own opinion. But in any case, what I'm going to show you does not depend on that. Okay, so the key finding is going to be the reversal of the education cleavage. So you have a complete reversal of the education gradient in the sense that at the beginning of the period, the more educated, the more you vote to the right. At the end of the period, the more educated, the more you vote to the left. This is highly significant, so I will show you some very simple linear regression where basically you introduce control. So you have a simple regression at the left on the left vote on various explanatory variables. So here, my first variable of interest will be high education. So you have a higher education degree. But then I will put control for age, sex, family situation, income, wealth, father, occupation. So if you have no control, this is simply the raw difference between the average vote for the two. But as you introduce control, you get the residual effect. Now, the bottom line is that this is not going to affect the result. So let me show you. So this is the first result with no control. Now, the first thing to have in mind is that, okay, here I just compare university graduate versus non-university graduate, but in fact, you can slice the data in different manners, and it's still going to be, so here, this is the result. I have 1956, 1973, 1995, 2012. So in 1956, you have 72% of the electorate, which has only a primary degree. So here, secondary education will be BAC, brevet, BEP. So you have only 72% who have primary degree in 1956. And this is the vote for the Socialist Communist Party. So you can see that this declines strongly with education. At the end of the period, so 2012, this is the election for Hollande, the second round, you have exactly the opposite pattern. If you take, you know, it's not only, so here these are only four elections, but it is the same if you look at all elections. So here, so these are all the elections at the beginning, you know, 1956, 58, 62, 65, always declining. Now, this is at the end, 2002, 2007, 2012, 2017, always increasing. Okay? Here you have all the election between 56, 2017. So you can see at the beginning, this is declining. Then in the middle, it's sort of flat. And then at the end, it's increasing. So when I show you the differential between university graduate and non-university graduate, I'm only showing you a little part of the data. In fact, it will also work if I will take secondary and primary education versus primary. Or, you know, you can slice the data in different ways. You can also look for the more, starting in the 1970s, I know whether you have an advanced university degree, typically grande école, master degree, doctorate, etc., rather than just a 2-year or 3-year degree. And it also works, you know, in the sense that at the beginning of the period, the advanced degree vote even more for the right, 1973. At the end of the period, the advanced degrees vote even more for the left. Okay, so no matter how you use the data, you always have this reversal of the education gradient. You know, it used to be the more educated don't like the left, the socialist, communist, you know, whatever they are, and at the end of the period, they like it more. Okay? So you have a complete change. So this is summarized by this graph. These are the confidence intervals. So you can see, especially at the beginning of the period, where the survey sample size is not very big, that you have big confidence interval. So be careful with comparing year-to-year elections. That's the bottom line. But for the long-run trend, we are fine. So this is meaningful. This is large, very much meaningful in the long run. We have no problem for the long-run trend. Okay. Now, what about the control? So, you know, you could say, well, okay, but, you know, at the end of the period, you know, you have these people with university degree who vote for Hollande, but it's just that these are young people, and, you know, young people, they're always crazy and excited and vote for the left. Well, you know, voting for Hollande when you're crazy and excited may not be the best thing to do, but anyway. Okay, that's partly true, except that it's always been like that. You know, it's always been like that, that younger people are a bit more educated because, you know, you have an increase of education over time, and younger people, other things equal, vote a bit more for the left. So if we control for age, you can see that the red curve is going down a little bit, which is exactly what you expect, because it means that part of the reason why the educated people at the end vote for the left is just because they are young. And once you control for their age, they vote a bit less for the left. So, okay, that's fine. But, you know, it's only a bit less. And it's always been like that. So it makes no difference at all for the trend. Okay, so that's an important point. Is that, you know, okay, you have an age effect, that's fine. But, you know, that's not at all what's driving the evolution. Because this age effect has always been there, and it has always been not huge. You know, meaningful, but not enormous. Now, if you control for income and wealth of the parents, what do you get? Well, it goes in the opposite way, which is that, you know, other things equal, okay, high education and high income tend to come together. But they don't always come together. I mean, if they were to come always together, then I could not find the results I find. So you have a correlation structure between income, education, and wealth. It's a positive correlation, but typically the correlation coefficient, you know, 0.3, 0.4 between education and wealth. And they have not really changed over time, by the way. It's sort of as a first approximation, but, you know, this is not the best data to measure this, but as a first approximation with the data we have, it's sort of stable over time. Now, higher income, as we will see later, tend to make you vote a bit more for the right. So, of course, when you control for income, the education effect increases. So it's the opposite way as for the age effect, because now, you know, if you're typically the people who will be the more for the left at the end will be people with low income, high education. But again, it's always been like that, so this changes the level of the curve, but this doesn't change the evolution. Here I control for father's occupation. So initially it was not parental income, parental wealth. It was individual income, individual wealth, sorry. And here I control for parental occupation, which I don't have throughout the study, but when I have it. So again, this goes in the same direction, but this doesn't change the evolution. I think this is the most meaningful one, where I look at top 10% minus bottom 90%. Okay, so we've seen this change in the education pattern. So what about the income pattern? Now, here, there are two main findings. You know, the first finding is that the wealth profile is always much stronger than the income profile. So, you know, the income profile if you look at the bottom 90%, so this is the income profile. So the income profile is that, you know, if you look at the bottom 90% of the population with no control, you don't have a strong profile. You know, people just vote the same way on average. Now, at the top, you have a strong profile. So the top income, they don't like the left too much, especially at the beginning of the period. You know, you can see 1978, you know, they don't vote for the left too much. Now, at the end of the period, you know, Hollande or Royal, you know, they like Hollande or Royal a bit more. Okay, so you have it becomes less downward sloping over time, but it's still a bit downward sloping. Now, let me show you the results for wealth using exactly the same scale. And so you can see that this is much stronger. So for those who know the data, you know, in most surveys, we actually don't have the exact value of wealth. We have it from some surveys, so we can check whether it works. But most of the time, what you can construct is a wealth indicator based on how many assets you own, different form of assets you own. But when you compare with the years for which you have the exact value of the asset, it gives you pretty much the same profile. So as a first approximation, it's okay. And so what would be the bottom 10% or the top 10% would be the top 10% of the population with the higher higher index value. Okay. And so if you have, you know, the way I deal with that always is the same with education. You know, assume you have 8% of the people with a university degree and then 20% with a secondary degree. What is the top decile? Well, you took the top 8%, the people who have university degree, and then you add 2% of the population in the people below. So by doing that, I sort of underestimate the gradient. And so this is underestimating the, in particular, the change in the gradient. But this probably has very little effect. I mean, in the end, I think this is the most meaningful way to compare this data over time. It's not perfect, but it's a bit less stupid than the other ways we have at our disposal. So anyway, the bottom line is that wealth matters a lot. So, you know, when you have a lot of property, you really don't like the left, okay? You know, look at the beginning of the period. Now, when you have no property at all, you really don't feel well represented by the right. Okay, so property, you know, asset ownership is a much more meaningful way. With the data here, especially for the long-run evolution, I'm not really able to distinguish between different type of property and whether it's risky investments. So, you know, Martial has thought a lot about that, and I have no disagreement about this kind of finding. But for this kind of long-run evolution, looking at the impact of wealth, I'm not really able to look at that. And I think the first-order finding is more that wealth matters a lot, even more than income. So what I'm going to do to summarize the evolution, I'm again going to focus on the top 10% income vis-à-vis bottom 90%, and I will do the same for wealth. Now, if you do that, here is what you get. So the green curve is for wealth, the blue curve is for income, and the red curve is for education. So first, what do we find? First, you see that the green is always below the blue, which is always below the red. What does it mean? It simply means that throughout the period, and we have that for Britain, for US, people with a lot of wealth vote a lot for the right. It is less true for income and less true for education. Okay, so wealth is always more strongly associated with the right vote than income, education. I mean, in a way, income, you can think of income as a sort of mixture of education and wealth. You know, how do you get a high income? Well, it's good to have high education. You know, this helps on average. It's also good to have a high property. You know, this can be useful. If you have both, you know, this is even better. But you know, it's not surprising that this income line is in between. Now, here, remember, it's a bit more subtle than this because it's after all controls. So you will get the same without the controls. But here, it's after controlling. So it's really measuring the residual effect of education, the residual effect of income, the residual effect in wealth. So what do you get? Well, at the beginning of the period, you have what I was describing earlier as the class-based conflict, where initially, you know, people at the bottom, in all dimensions, are aligned and they vote for the socialist and communist. So it's, you know, and people, and so the opposite of voting for the left here is voting for the right, okay, because I just take everybody. Now, at the end of the period, so this changed gradually. At the end of the period, we have this sort of multiple elite conflict in the sense that the high education vote for socialist, communist, well, less and less communist, but socialist, communist, green. And whereas the high wealth people and, to a lesser extent, high income people, they still vote for the right. Now, I have put a dashed line for 2017. 2017, of course, is a complicated election, but it's still interesting to see that, in a way, it is in the continuity of the previous election. So look for education. So here, what I look for 2017 is the following. I look at the first round of the presidential election, and I put the left-hand half of the vote with the right-hand. So how does it work? Well, as you know, if you add up Mélenchon, Hamon, the small left-wing candidate, and Macron, you get like 51% of the vote. And if you add up Fillon, Le Pen, Dupont-Aignan, and the other small right-wing candidate, you get like 49%. Okay. Again, I'm not saying these are meaningful coalitions, but you know, if you ask people where they come from, if you ask people to locate these parties from left to right, you will get about this classification. So these are two half. Now, if you take these two half as given, this is what you get. So this means that for the education vote, it's very close to the Hollande vote of 2012. For income and wealth vote, you can see that Macron is attracting some high income and high wealth people, but it's not enough to counterbalance completely the people who vote for Mélenchon and Hamon, etc. So in the end, if you put all these people together, you know, the high income, high wealth still vote a bit more for the right, especially Fillon. So I have put a dashed line in 2017 because, of course, you know, as we all know, you know, there could have been many other second round vote, and you know, things could have changed. But you know, this is what we get with what we have. So this is the same as before, except that I look at top 10% education versus bottom 90% education. Now, what is the explanation for why the low education voters have stopped voting for the left? So in the US debate, you know, standard explanation for a long time has been, well, you know, following the standard explanation, to summarize in one word, has been racism, you know, to the right. So following the civil rights movement in the 1960s, the poor white, and especially the poor white from the South, have stopped voting for the Democratic Party. They have gradually shifted to the Republicans. This did not start with Trump. This started with Nixon, with Reagan, with Bush, and now with Trump. But this is a long-run evolution, and this is the story. And you know, there's not much we can do about it because we've done everything we can to do the right policy for these poor people, but they are so racist that, you know, what can we do? I mean, this is one point of view which I put it to the extreme, but that's one story that's in there. Now, what I'm going to argue is that if you look at the French and UK evolution, where you have this same kind of general evolution, this story is not fully convincing because, okay, you have a migration issue in Europe, which could have generated a similar shift, except that migration becomes salient relatively later in Europe, you know, maybe more in the 80s, 90s. And this evolution starts before that. You know, it starts in the 60s, 70s. So one of the points, I mean, you cannot be sure about this, because in the end, I think both processes are important. But one of my points I'm trying to make is that although the racial or migration religious cleavage in the European case is certainly, you know, has become more salient and has become more important and explains part of this change, I think there's more going on. And I think one of the theses I'm trying to defend in this research is that the process of educational expansion per se, irrespective of racial issues or ethnic conflict, has changed a little bit the term of the political conflict in the sense that, you know, you come from a situation where everybody has primary education and only a small elite has tertiary degrees. Now, once you have more and more people going to higher education, you know, some of the people whose parents, grandparents had no degree, they managed to make it to higher education. Some people don't manage to make it. They stay in secondary or sometimes primary education. And the reason why it's only those who make it who sort of keep voting for the left or sometimes who start voting for the left is probably because the left, in the meantime, you know, has developed an ideology of educational meritocracy, if you want, which is not very, you know, which is maybe is not exactly the same as the sort of business elite meritocracy, but which in the end is tends to be a bit... regarding down at those who did not make it or those who did not achieve. Or at least this is the way many people who did not succeed in education look at this Brahmin left. And so one of my points in this research is going to say, if you want to explain why you have this similar evolution of low education voters leaving the left in all of these countries, you really have to look at the education policy itself, the social policy, the policy toward inequality, and just blaming racism and ethnic conflict is not fully convincing because this starts much, much earlier conflict about migration begin. I mean, that being said, you know, we are not in the area of controlled experiment. We are not going to redo the story again without migration. So, you know, there's no way you can be completely sure about the different factors. So how do we look at the, racial conflict in the case of Europe? It's complicated because it's only in the recent election that you have questions about the country of birth of your grandparents for the elector, which is the best way to look at it. For the earlier election, you know, starting in the 70s, you only have questions about religion, which is not very satisfactory. But still, I'm going to use this data here. So this is the religious map of France, 1967-2012, according to the post-electoral survey. So in the post-electoral survey, you ask people, do you have a religion? How much do you practice? So the practicing here, I think I have put the people who say they go to the church at least once a month. I'm not even sure they do it, but this is what they say. And as you can see, you know, they are only 6%. So this is really going down, but you still have a large group who says to be Catholic non-practicing. Now you have this small group of Muslims over there who are 5% in the 2012 survey. These are only people who have the right to vote, who are registered to vote, and who do vote. Okay, so if you take the entire population, it would be more 8%, 9%, 10%, whatever, but it would be more than 5. But still, this 5% is a lot more than the 0% you used to have before. If you look at the voting pattern, so we all know that the Catholic vote goes more to the right, and over time, this has become a bit less salient. What is more striking is this feature of the Muslim vote, so to speak, or people who describe themselves as Muslim, which looks a lot like the black vote in the US, with 90% vote for what. Now this is very striking. Now some people. So this, as you probably have noticed, this has become a serious source of tension in this country, with some people pretending that this is because the left like Muslim extremists or whatever. I think the more likely explanation is that Muslim voters feel that there is a lot of hostility on the other side and the right inside. And to me, this is a well enough explanation to explain this pattern. But in any case, this is quite striking to have to see that. So at the beginning of the period in the 80s, once you have the data, you don't have many observations, so it's not very significant. But at the end of the period, you start to have a number of observations that is sufficiently meaningful, and you can see the magnitude of the effect, 40 percentage point effect. So remember, for high education, it was maybe 10 percentage point effect. So this. The effect of religious cleavage or racial cleavage in the case of the US is really quite enormous. If you put the income education control, that's going to go down a little bit, but not so much, like in the US. So it's not only, so of course, people who report themselves as Muslim have lower income, wealth, etc. But that's only part of the story. Okay, that's comparing with the question on grandparents. So starting in 2007, you have a question of, do you have foreign grandparents? So you can see, so you have about, in 2012, you have 20% of the population who describe themselves as having at least one foreign grandparent. 28%, about 30%. And out of this 28%, you have 19% who have a European foreign grandparent. It's mostly Italy, Spain, Portugal, and 9% who report non-European foreign grandparents. That's mostly North Africa and a little bit sub-Saharan Africa. And so you can see that the people with European foreign origins, they vote like the others. The people with extra European origin, you have 77%. If you control, you take Muslim vote and control for the origin, for a North African origin, you still have this Muslim effect, and it's still significant. I mean, I don't want to go too much into the detail about this. Let me go compare very quickly to what we get for the US. Okay, so US, I'm going to look at these presidential elections, So you all know U.S. presidential election, you know, from 1948 to 2016, where Clinton got 51% of the vote, and also Trump is saying the opposite. But from according to my data sources, this is what we. What we have, sorry for the Trumpist in the room, but and we are going to compare the voting pattern for this for Democratic and Republican candidates. So first, if you look by ethnic group, you can see that in the 50s, the black electorate was not particularly Democrat, and if you were to go back 50 years before, it would have been entirely Republican right after the Civil War. But then after the civil rights movement in the 60s, they turned 90% Democrat, and it's always been like that since then. Okay? So there would have been basically no Democrat president with only the white electorate for more than half a century. Okay? So it's very, very strong. So. Look at this. You know, you have again this 40% effect. So it's very close to this the Muslim or non-European foreign grandparent effect that we had for France. And you put the control for age checks, education. You still have so the you know the racial dimension is obviously very strong. If you compare France and the U.S., you know it's interesting to see that. So in the U.S., you have 12% black and 18% Latinos. And the Latinos in the US are sort of intermediate between the white and the black in terms of voting pattern. Now, of course, Latinos are to a large extent a construction, and there was actually recently some debate where you know Trump wanted to suppress one of the boxes in the census questionnaire in order to put all Latinos in one box, etc. So this is all a construction, and you know the. In a way, you know, these are the Latinos of France because they have mostly Italian origin, like my family, or Spanish origins, like my wife's family. And so, you know, and except that the Latinos of France, you know, are not perceived like Latinos and they don't look at themselves as, you know, maybe in part because the social fabric and the educational system and, you know, whatever is making people closer to one another has sort of also managed to make them closer to one another. So it's not. Something that's given. Now, so, you know, there are some commonalities between the 10% voting in a very particular way, you know, for the Democratic or for the left, but there are some big difference, which is this big group, intermediate group in the middle in the US. Now, if you look at the vote by education, you can see in 2016, people with a PhD. You know, you have 2% of the population with a PhD in the U.S. in 2016, and they vote, you know, almost 80% for Hillary Clinton. You know, I don't even know where are the other 20% because it's hard to, you know, to go to U.S. universities. So now, in 1948, it was exactly the opposite. In 1948, the high education will vote Republican. Okay, so you have, again, a complete change in the pattern. The only reason why the voters with primary degree in 2016 keep voting Democrats is because of the race effect. If you control for race, it's not true anymore. So if you look at the evolution of the education profile, this is what you get. Okay, so this is the comparison between France and the US for the education vote, and you can see you know, how close this is. And so this is where I say, okay, the civil rights explanation for the US is not fully convincing because you have to say, okay, what was the civil rights movement in France in the 1960s? You know, at least the racial dimension or the migration dimension for the voting pattern in the 60s, 70s, 80s in France is not obvious. I mean, it starts in Britain. If you look some elections in the 1970s, in particular the Thatcher election, but also the election before, migration is starting to play a role. But I think it's much less of a role than later. And so the fact that it starts very much, I mean, one of my purpose here with this finding, in a way, is to try to denationalize the study of nationalism, which I think if you look at the different patterns, you see so much similarities that I think the problem has more to do with the policy platform of the left, to summarize, and how redistributive it is or not with respect to the low education group than with racial attitude. I mean, just to summarize, this is what I take from these results, is that the similarity suggests that there are deep factors that are not specific to the specific nature of the racial conflict in these different countries. Now, in the US, one particularity is that the high-income people turned Democrat for the first time in 2016. Now, it could be that this is just because Trump is completely crazy, and once the Republicans come with a more reasonable candidate, you know, the high-income people will go back to the Republican. We don't know. You know, there is a possibility that at some point, you know, also the high-income group move with the high-education group, and in the end, you have a complete reversal of the conflict between where, you know, the what used to be the left because a sort of high-income, high-education alliance, sort of pro-globalization, sort of winners of globalization alliance, whereas the people at the bottom becomes more like a social racist alliance, which is a little bit what was the Democratic Party in the US at the end of the 19th century, before gradually becoming the New Deal Party. But it took a long time and a lot of violence in the meantime, and particularly in the south of the US, before they became the good guys, if you want. So this is a transition that can happen, but if you have the same transition and wait for Orban or Le Pen or Salvini to become the future New Deal parties, the corresponding cost in terms of violence can be pretty high. But you know, this is a kind of evolution which you may want to worry about looking at this kind of pattern here. Now, for Britain, so I 1 minute on Britain. So you all know Britain. Sorry for all the Liberal Democrat supporters in the room. I just skip them out. I just look at Labour and Conservative. My only excuse is that in 1945, Liberal get less than 10%, and in 2016, they get also less than 10%. Now, in the middle, they got sometimes quite a lot of the vote, but here, to simplify the map, I only look at Labour versus Conservative. And so what you get is basically the same pattern for education as what we had for US and France, except that this is lagging behind. You know, it takes a very long time, and it's only at the very end of the period that high education really turned Labour. So this is looking at top 10% education. So here it's more in the 2000, 1990s, so around Blair times that they turned Labour. If you compare with France and the US, you know, Britain is clearly lagging behind, but in the end, it's going in the same direction. Now, maybe what's most interesting is the fact that the high-income people in Britain, they don't like Corbyn at all. Okay, so maybe they don't like Brexit, but they hate Corbyn even more than they hate Brexit, to summarize. So in the end, at the very last election, you know, they turned back to the Conservative very strongly. So it's very different from the US, where the high-income go in the same direction as the high education and, you know, go to Hillary Clinton versus Trump. So this is important because this means that the supply side of the political process matters, which is obvious. So in this presentation, you know, I have talked mostly about the structure of the electorate, but of course, to understand this, you need to look at what the parties are proposing. And this is a clear example where, you know, the Corbyn offer has not the same impact as the Hillary Clinton offered. And if it had been Sanders in the US instead of Hillary Clinton, there would have been also a difference. So the bottom line is that these are not deterministic evolution, that once you include this multidimensionality of political conflict, this becomes a lot more complicated and also a lot more interesting than the, you know, median voter model or kind of dynamics you get in a one-dimensional setting. And here, you know, it's a bit trivial to say that, but we are at a form of juncture in the sense that, you know, you have at least two different possible evolutions. One where the high income move with the high education, one where the cleavage tend to exacerbate, and you can think of other possible evolution as well. So this is for Britain, this is for France, where, certainly the Macron electorate, you know, puts a strong force to go in the direction of this, Clinton-Trump cleavage, which we get here at the end of the period, but, you know, this could also change in the future. This was a Muslim vote for Britain, which looks a lot like in France, 90% vote for Labour, so this is very strong as well. Okay, I'm just going to stop there, basically. So conclusion, the general message is that, you know, globalization, migration, and educational expansion have created new dimensions of conflict and which have contributed to the collapse of the post-war left versus right party system, or at least this is my interpretation. So why did not democracy reduce inequality? You know, one simple and a bit trivial answer is that because multidimensional coalitions are complicated. And if you don't have, so more specifically, really what I have in mind is that if you don't have a strong egalitarian platform coming from the internationalist side, then it's going to be very difficult to have the low education, low income voters from different origins vote for the same party anymore. And I think racism, nativism, and higher education are very powerful forces to divide the poor if you don't have a strong uniting platform, which maybe was the particular, you know, time in the 50s, 60s where you had with the setup of social security and reduction in economic inequalities in all forms, you know, a strong uniting platform which could put together people with different origins. The good news is that, you know, I think social sciences can help, and, you know, although this is all descriptive, I think this is suggestive of at least, you know, taking seriously this long-run evolution. So thanks a lot for your attention.
Ok, je vais commencer en français pour les félicitations, et puis je passerai à l'anglais pour la substance. Bon, merci de m'avoir invité à commenter ce texte, ce très long texte. Je ne sais pas si vous avez tous pris connaissance des 170 pages, mais il y a beaucoup de matière. Je commencerai donc. I'm going to switch in English to address five comments and on different issues. My first comment, it's not a provocative comment, but I just want to know what economics, or what does economics bring us in our understanding on these new cleavages. Okay, I wanted to be sure about that.
You got it right.
So, and I was waiting for this response. So my second question is, how do you think that what you examine across three different countries with different electoral systems, different institutional rules, could help us to understand how these new cleavages, political cleavages that you observe over time, could help us to go beyond what political scientists usually used, the Lipset-Rokin approach. And you mentioned in your paper that the classical view to understand how to characterize liberal or modern democracies is to oppose center to periphery, state against churches, or agriculture against industry, and workers or blue collars versus white collars. And you say it's not enough. We have to take into account the rise of inequalities and different types of inequalities, not only income inequalities, but also capital inequalities, and your demonstration about the rise of both material conditions is for me very useful. And I don't, it's my second question, I'm not sure that we should compare in the same way income inequalities and capital inequalities. And especially for France, and to some point for Britain, it seems that income inequalities has less effect on the divide between left and right than capital inequalities. And what you mentioned about the wealth as a good predictor for right vote has been empirically demonstrated, but I'm not sure to know exactly in your paper and other papers how to measure, how to explain, or what is the causes of such relationship between inequality, capital inequalities in terms of revenues and the rise of right. And now the new cleavage is not only the rise of right, it's just the rise of populism. That's the point of your paper. And for me, it seems to be not clear how to associate the rise of capital inequalities to any explanation for the rise of populism. It seems to be out of the picture. The third comment is about the consequences of your results. You said that politics is like a long-standing fight, struggle for getting winning coalitions. And you argue that the classical coalition of left versus coalition of right is now changing to make possible a new competitive coalition within left and right against a new coalition of populist parties. And this new coalition of populist parties is likely to welcome voters with low education, low income, and low wealth. I'm not sure about this interpretation. Why? Because I interpret the rise of far left in France, for instance. In US and Britain, it's more complicated to have the same comparison, but I interpret the rise of far left in France saying that voters for the same level of education who voted for Mélenchon, for instance, it's just because they have lower income than voters who voted for Macron or Fillon. So the puzzle is, why people having the same level of education prefer to vote for Mélenchon than Fillon? Is it just because they expect to, and they have a differential of income? But the question is why? Is it just because, and that's my fourth point, and you, it seems that you want to make the empirical demonstration, it's just because they have, They could expect different position due to the level of education, meaning that 50 years ago, with a college degree, you could be a white collar. It's not the case today, and because you anticipate that you could not get such a position, you are less likely to vote for parties or coalition that could expect from them, in terms of redistributive policy, to offer you such a position. So you prefer to vote for extreme parties just to as an alternative to get the position. And you mentioned in survey that you have used the position obtained by your father. And I think it's an important variable to see the social mobility over time for such voters. So my interpretation is, it's not necessarily the question of low education and low income push you to vote for populist parties. My interpretation, I know that you could not get such data. My feeling is that, because we did that for the last presidential election, it seemed that people who vote for populist party, they are not like poor voters, they are more unhappy voters. And it means that, in a sense, subjective well-being or trust are also a good proxy, I mean, to explain the changing structure of new political cleavages. The story about the story of the narrative that you mentioned about the rise of inequalities and rise of populisms is also a question for me in terms of big question. How should we interpret your results regarding the emergence of populist parties? It seems it seems regarding your many graphs that there is a turning point at the end of 80s in Britain, in France, and roughly in US, more in the mid of 90s for the US. So, and you mentioned that in your paper, it's not only the rise of inequalities, but also the globalization and migration. So my question is, how could you go further on this field, globalization and migration, to confirm that globalization and migration are, to some point, interplayed with this rise of inequalities? So it's just a question of causality. Is it just the consequences of rise of inequalities, or is it just something totally different? And looking at simultaneously, they just amplified the rise of new political cleavages. Two final points. A methodological question. You have proceed stacked many survey data post election surveys, in which voters declare to take part of the vote. Are you confident, or are you able to confirm your results looking at new abstainers over time? Because for me, it's not clear that, because I suspect that the main pattern you highlight is also the consequences of a decreasing turnout rate over time. And if you, and especially not for presidential election, because the turnout rate is to some point a constant, but for legislative elections, there is a huge variation over time in terms of turnout rate. So you could say that the Brahmin left is, in terms of sociology, is totally different with more educated people and so on and so on. But is it not just people remaining participants? Mm-hmm. And the in a sense, the Brahmin left has pushed out of the political game many citizens. And the last question, sorry, it's too many questions, but do you think that how to interpret that? My question is, I just try to interpret the political consequences of your empirical results. If I was the leader of the Democrat Party in US, your work should be very useful to define, to design the new campaign in terms of strategy. But is it important? What I want to say, you demonstrate that highly educated voters but also in highly educated constituencies, the party in a sense and the left has been ineffective to protect material interests of the less well-off. So my question is, we know that, because I didn't talk about what we in political science use in terms of voting class, or class voting, sorry. And we know that it doesn't no longer matter because workers do not vote for left parties But is it just due to inequalities? That's your argument. I propose another argument, saying that it's just the logic of redistributive policies. If the left is not has decided to pay more attention to these new educated people, voters, it's just a question in terms of, I mean, political economy to respond to the median voter, and the median voter is more educated. So in terms of redistributive policies, how to address people who are very far from the median voter? That's the question about in France for Hollande, not for Macron, because I'm not able to say that Macron has targeted policies during the campaign to reach or to target the median voter. I don't know exactly. But for the classical opposition between left and right, left was winning in France, in US, not really in Britain, just because precisely people were more and more educated. So I prefer to stop there.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And
Thank you. Je ferai comme Martial, je commencerai les compliments en français et je passerai aux questions et aux critiques en anglais. Merci de m'avoir donné l'occasion de lire à fond ce texte, parce que je l'avais lu cet été, vite, mais là ça m'a obligé à aller le relire les 174 pages en détail. Et je voudrais dire d'abord tout le plaisir que j'ai eu à le lire, parce que d'abord il y a un vrai puzzle. Pourquoi est-ce que les inégalités augmentent et, en fait, ça ne profite pas à la gauche et aux partis redistributeurs, mais aux partis populistes de droite, ceux qui m'intéressent. Il y a une thèse sur les élites multiples. Surtout, ce qui est bien, c'est que c'est sur le long terme et c'est qu'on compare trois pays et pas 50, comme certains de ces projets comparatifs, donc trois pays qu'on peut analyser de près et que c'est des très bonnes données, on les connaît, c'est les nôtres. Donc c'est des données post-électorales, mais ça change de ceux qui travaillent avec European Social Survey, qui n'est absolument pas une enquête électorale et qu'on utilise à tort et à travers. Ce qui est bien, c'est qu'il y a des contrôles, puisqu'on oublie très souvent, mais là c'est toutes choses égales par ailleurs, donc c'est du costaud. Et ce qui est bien, c'est de revenir sur ces variables qui ont été, en matière de clivage, moins étudiées, revenus, diplômes et patrimoine, l'invention de Capdevielle et du Poirier. Alors, ceci posé, je voudrais poser quand même un certain nombre de questions d'un point de vue de science politique et d'un point de vue de méthode, hein, les mains dans le cambouis. Bon. Sorry. Strange. Alors, là, j'attaque en anglais. The first thing, and it goes a little with what you said, is... What is for you a political cleavage? Because you say, you claim you are working in the line of Lipset and Rocan, but when they speak of a cleavage, they speak of a social base, a world vision, parties and organization that represent you. Is there a class of the more than $20,000 income? Is there a class with education? What exactly do you mean by cleavage? Because you announce you're going to speak about the changing structure of cleavages, but these are not cleavages. And there are even less castes, because that would mean that you are for life, a merchant, a Brahmin, or a paria. The second question would be about the index you use. They're beautiful, your graphs, and in color. And the most beautiful, of course, are those where you simplify, where you say the proportion of the higher decile of income that votes for the left minus the proportion of the 90% left over who vote for the left. And you do the same for education, and it's very pretty. The problem, it's exactly what Alford did for the class voting, and there's tons of work saying it's not a good index. You are using the Alford index for your graphs, even though you control and do far better than... Why? Why didn't you use odds ratios? Because when you do something like that, the 10% higher incomes versus all the other, the 10% who went to university versus the others, you have very heterogeneous categories, even though sometimes you split out. But the part on the right is very heterogeneous. And it's even more heterogeneous when you oppose the left to all the others. Well, we've had a tripolarization of the political scene in France, but in many other countries, since the 80s. Do you really have the right to oppose the left to tout le reste? I don't think so, but maybe you can convince me. But that's all the critics that were given to the Alford Index apply in that case. The third thing, religion is very important, class and religion. But isn't it kind of risky to put into your models Muslims, the religious Muslims? Because I looked, as you said, it's even at the best moment, you have 70 Muslims in the very last surveys. So, and is there such a thing as a Muslim vote? Is there such a thing as a Jewish vote? I mean, what, there's a lot of work showing that it's not being Muslim, it's being for immigrant born. Not only all things age, gender, education control, did the work of Tiberi and Brouard. So could you develop a little bit about that? You already said that, but it seems to me important, you work on the expressed votes. That means that you work on the registered voters. That already eliminates 10% of the potential voters. Then it's survey, an electoral survey. You lose the people who have less education and who are in the lower classes. And then you have all the people who don't answer the questions. I've just worked on the 2017 presidential election, the CEE d'État, it's called FES, French Election Survey, 2017, yeah, I think you use one of them. And what's very interesting is if you use an indicator of social precariousness, which is not only material, but also social isolation, cultural isolation, in the highest quintile of people precarious, in the second round, 53% didn't express a vote. More than half. That means you have a hell of a lot of people out of your political landscape, and that's getting worse. Then the other problem would be political supply. You hinted at it a little. I think it's really important to put it back in because these elections mean nothing if you don't take into consideration who are the parties, the leaders, and what are their programs. And I was thinking of, you could be more cumulative. You did already quite a big step as an economist, but maybe you could come even closer to a couple of works written by political scientists. One of them is the Evans and de Graaf Political Choice Matters. They have a fantastic database, comparative data set on cleavage voting, and it goes from 1962 to 2007. So you could bring that into, because it's not only the Cevipof surveys, you also have other surveys, and they show very clearly that part of the process is bottom up, but the other part of the process, and in some countries far more important, is up, down. That's the way the parties have framed the cleavages that make the cleavage relevant, not the cleavages themselves. Then maybe two quick questions. One would be, you never talked about the recession. Did it have, and you're an economist, did it have absolutely no impact on the cleavages, on the electoral choices recently? Could you develop that? And then what about work? It's very nice to put into the picture income, education, and wealth. But what about the transformations of the labor market? What about, and you won't contradict me, Jan, what about the outsiders? What about the precariousness which is growing? Isn't there the base of the cleavage that you could put into the perspective? And the last thing is, how would you define what's really new in your work? Because I was looking at, if you take the second dimension, the cultural dimension, that goes back to the end of the 80s with Middendorp and the work on the second dimension cultural. If you look at, let's go to Bourdieu. Bourdieu in La Distinction in 1979 does a very nice presentation of the political landscape, and he does exactly what you are doing. He says, he cuts it in four, and those who have economic capital plus educational capital, those who have plus plus, minus minus, but he says those who really matters are those who have much economic power but little cultural, the small shopkeepers, they go to the right. It's a chiasm, as he likes to say. And then you have those who have no economic capital but a lot of cultural capital, and already they were voting for the left. So sometimes wouldn't it be useful to go back to old Bourdieu? And maybe I think I stop there to leave more time for the discussion.
Thank you very much for having me, and thank you, Thomas, for a great presentation. My praises will be in English, so that even the foreigners can hear them. What I really appreciate about it is that you kind of cut through political science in a way that we sometimes have a hard time doing ourselves. I love the long trend time series. I love the fact that you don't bother with our terminology. We will criticize you for it because that's our job, but I think it's kind of great. You know, don't worry too much about how they do it, but just do it yourself with the good data that they have. I will stick to the 4 points that I think your work highlights. I think you've made really 4 fundamental claims. The first one is that there is decline in class voting. The second one, that there is income voting, that the wealthy vote for the right, hence the merchant right. And the second one is that there is an inversion of the education voting. Educated voted for the right, now they vote for the left. And finally, that there is a creation of this new cleavage of globalists versus nativists. So I will follow my colleagues in kind of pointing out some of the parts that we've known before and suggest maybe some of the literature that we are proud of as a discipline. But I will suggest that it's point 3 that I think is, and that's the inversion of the education, that is really the most interesting and that I find, at least personally, most innovative. And I will engage you on that. All right, so here is, you know, decline of class voting is the bread and butter of electoral political science. It has been done for 40 years. Income voting, non-controversial, right? The wealthy do vote right, they have voted right. It's the inversion of the education voting that's super interesting. And the new cleavage argument, as Nona has suggested, has been around. I know more the English written literature, so here is Creasy, Kitchelt, Hoche, and Marx. Now, let's look at the education argument. I would suggest that the education finding that you present is really a proxy. And it's fundamentally a proxy for 2 things. It's a proxy for the changing structure of work and production, on the one hand, which Nona has mentioned. And secondly, it's a proxy for the change of values of voters, which is strongly linked to the salience of the 2 dimensions that you engage in the paper you didn't talk so much about in the talk. So your model considers, you didn't talk about the model, but in the paper you have a model that really considers openness as a function of taxation ability, or really inability, right, the evasion for taxation, and migration as kind of the fundamental basis for this flip. But I think that you should importantly consider the structural change of work and production, which stems out of education, and which is also associated with this value change of voters. And I will suggest you have this wonderful question in the middle of your paper that says, could all of this happen without migration? And I will say yes, absolutely. It could happen without migration. Migration has deepened it extensively, but it was already starting to happen without it. Okay, so let me start. I like pictures. Pictures are worth 1,000 words. By that measure, your paper is very long. But I will use a couple thousand of words of my own. I will use your 4 quadrants, but I will draw them in the 2-dimensional space. So this is very typical for political scientists, started by Kitchelt in his 94 book. This is, just to make myself clear, economic left, they like the state. Economic right, they like the market. And then here is the second dimension that political scientists and sociologists have debated at length. They give it tons of different names. It's really confusing. You don't worry about that. It's liberal conservative. Let's just keep it at that. Interestingly, and there's work that suggests this, the liberal tend to be more educated consistently, and the conservative tend to be less educated consistently. Now, let me try to place some significant social groups into this space. This is really following the work of Kitchelt, Oesch, and a number of others. In the 1950s and 60s, this is how I would kind of very schematically place it there. The important thing is that this is the workers' quadrant, primarily, right? And then this is the educated people's quadrant, with a small number, relatively small number, of people who would effectively be left intellectuals. They're journalists, writers, very few liberal professionals. I would suggest that at this point, and I mean, you've kind of engaged it, and maybe you've dispelled, I had a hypothesis when I was reading your paper that at this time there was a stronger correlation between income and education. Maybe it's not the case. But it would, you know, if you had a university degree, if you were a doctor, lawyer, engineer, you were probably going to be well off in these days. There was just no big problem, nothing to worry about in terms of your income. Right? Now, what happens during this period? Massive rise of education. Farmers' kids, workers' kids, they get to go to college, right? Unprecedented, absolutely unprecedented. This changes the world. What does it do? It takes these people and it pulls them up, It pulls them up into completely new professional structures, and it gives them different values, hence the 68ers, right? So here's the first line. The line is like this. Then come the 1990s and onwards, and this thing becomes much more complicated. Here we still have various skilled, unskilled, precarious, but what appears here is important. We get the so-called sociocultural professionals, and this is Daniel Usher's work. And the sociocultural professionals are highly educated, but not particularly rich, and they are overwhelmingly left-supporting, right? So what we effectively get is a bit of a triangular structure where we have the poor, the wealthy, but wealthy relatively educated, and not so wealthy, but very educated. So different production, different structure. This increases, oh, and by the way, this is also connected, and this is Olivier who has suggested this, right? This is connected to the different sectors. This is public sector workers overwhelmingly. This is private sector workers overwhelmingly. The size of the public sector has grown immensely between these periods. So this increases the salience of the non-economic dimension, which now divides these people from these people, and the economic dimension that divides these people from these people. Now, I will parrot Nona. Political scientists like the word cleavage, and some important works that have suggested that it has to have three components, right? It's not just that it's there, but it is that people are aware of it. And actually, the work of Rune Stubager, a Danish political scientist, shows that education is important, but that there actually isn't a group consciousness, or it's not very strong, right? I don't feel myself different because I'm a Sciences Po professor. And I somehow identify as such and will vote for a Sciences Po party. Political expression is the final important component of cleavages, right? And so supply and party. So let me go back to my space and put the parties in there. And this is the thing that also struck me on your work. The socialists have always been on the liberal end of the spectrum because Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels end the manifesto with the words, "Workers of the world unite." They are internationalists. In the words of Lipset, the role of the workers' movement and of socialist parties has been the emancipation and so effectively lifting up of the working classes who were overwhelmingly and remain in this quadrant, right, in the conservative left quadrant, and associating them with political supply that is liberal, right, led by a whole bunch of intellectuals who were liberal themselves, people like Jean Jaurès or Léon Blum. They are all highly educated guys. They are not factory workers, but they elevated the factory workers to vote for positions that were effectively socially liberal. So I will argue that the left has always been Brahmin because of this, right? Even though, of course, it was largely supported by non-Brahmins, but they were made Brahmins by this virtue. So the structure of competition is like this in Western Europe. It connects the liberal left with mostly more conservative right. Now, as we have this great change caused by education, but effectively meaning the restructuring of the workplace and the types of work that people do, associated with the personal liberation expressed in 1968 on the streets right around here, we get a major shift of the political supply that expresses the interests of these new sociocultural professionals of all hues, particularly the green parties, but also the socialists and to a lesser extent the radical left. And so already, before immigration becomes salient, before immigrant parties become really particularly relevant in Western Europe, you already have this attenuation of the liberal dimension and the placement of political supply that mobilizes people on this dimension over issues of women's rights, sexual liberation, all of those good things, but not really directly related to the radical right. The radical right and migration appear really in the 1980s, 90s with Haider in Austria. And then the radical right engages and effectively opposes this new left with the agenda that's centered on immigration. And that restructures the political system, right? The line is now much steeper. There is more variance and therefore more competition over the non-economic dimension. The variance here, if you weighted by vote, is much smaller. So it's weakening. Just to drive my point home, here is the electoral manifesto data. It's a very problematic data. Don't use it at home. Use the Chapel Hill Expert Survey instead. Sorry. Advertisement, but This data shows that overwhelmingly the left parties, here this is the French socialists and the French communists, they have overwhelmingly been towards the liberal end of that spectrum. So they have liberalized the voters. So the fundamental question is, what is going on for me with the left conservative quadrant? And this is the Chapel Hill Expert Survey data, which is great, but unfortunately very short time series, 1999 to 2017. This is the movement of the major party families in Western Europe over the last 20 years. What has happened is that the left has lost the connection with this quadrant. It has lost the connection with whoever now the lower classes, the precarious, the skilled and unskilled workers are. They have moved away from them. They have moved further to the liberal pole. But even the radical left has moved more liberal and a little more left. The liberals, they are not really relevant in this context, but they moved away as well. And the major right has moved away as well. The only political party family that is moving in to capture them is, of course, the radical right. They're moving closer towards capturing this quadrant. Okay, so this is, to me, really the dynamic of what is going on with this educational change, is the fact that the uneducated who have been liberalized by the socialists have been dropped by them, or have dropped themselves. And now they are free game. And it's the fascists who are coming in, as it was in the case of the 30s. Pardon my F words. To elites, yes. I mean, I think this is the story of the 2000s, right? There's the left and the right, but this is the precipitous fall of the left that has been detached from the left authoritarian or conservative quadrant. And so the direction of this left Brahmin elite is concerning, right? It is problematic because they have lost that quadrant, and I don't know how they will regain it. And that's a question that you raise, and I wish I had an answer. This is the political space of the French 2017 election from the data collected by Nicolas Sauget and the Centre d'études européennes. These are mean voter placements. And if you add in the contemporary preferences for votes, Marine Le Pen, the last things I saw on the internet this afternoon, is polling at around 23-25%, Macron at around 18, these guys at around 10 and 5 respectively, and the right is polling at around 10 as well. So it suggests that the competition is now here, and that the left conservative quadrant is actually picked up by Le Pen and the Front National. So effectively, this might be the new left elite, right, in a very problematic sense. So this leaves me with the following conclusions. I think that the education profile change is effectively capturing the major structural change in work and production and associated value change. The education increase has led to these post-material values written about by Engelhardt, which increase the salience of the non-economic dimension independent of migration, prior to migration, before the 80s, when people in Western Europe realized that, hey, there are people from other places that are staying. Migration, of course, strengthens this salience exponentially, potentially, makes that dimension dominant. This is blown up, of course, by the so-called migration crisis. The left was always Brahmin. It always liberalized workers, but it was able to do it. It was able to hang on to them. And I think you suggest why, because they were doing it on the economic dimension. They were providing clear socio-economic welfare policies that held them, and they didn't care so much about the fact that they talked about internationalism. They really didn't care about workers in Hungary or in Chile, right? But they accepted it. Now they don't accept it anymore. So that has been lost. The old connection, that conservative quadrant, has been lost. So this left conservative quadrant is now being captured by the radical right. And so for me, the big question is the left dead? And I end on that very, very depressing note. Thank you so much.
So before starting the discussion and Q&A with the room and Thomas' answers, I have a news. It may be a bad or a good news. Thomas asked me to have a lot of time because, as you have seen, he has a lot of slides. And so in order to grant him a lot of time, I say, oh, maybe there will be time after 7 p.m. for Q&A with the room. And there is. So we can extend by a quarter of minutes for having more time for discussion. So those who want to leave at 7 p.m., they can, of course. But in silence. And maybe to leave time for Thomas to ruminate all those comments, I will take three questions, and there will be a first package of answers from Thomas. Do you agree?
Okay. Yeah.
So please raise hand. And a rather short question, and we'd give more time for other questions.
Yeah. First of all, so I'm Farhad. First of all, thank you so much for the really interesting presentation. What I had in mind all the way through the presentation was that the fact that the voter turnout has fallen throughout the 20th century. And that also means it's directly connected with the fact that the voters has also gone to the extremes. I can at least talk of the case of the United States, that before there were more people falling in between undecided, but now that percentage has fallen so much. So I wanted to know if you have taken that fact into account in this study, and what the influence of that kind of shift in trend has been in the results of the study. Thank you so much.
So thank you for the very interesting discussion. My question would be that what have you taken into consideration the rise of social media and how it could, it's a double-edged sword and it could either democratize more or it could work the other way around. Thank you.
Hi. So thanks for the presentation. I just looked up some data about the Brazilian election, and I saw that your higher education trend, I saw that in Brazil's election last year, the higher educated group voted more for Bolsonaro, so the far right, and the group with least education voted for the left. So how do you explain this? This result.
Come on, so first package.
Yes. So, well, maybe I should go back there. So, well, actually, the last question. Let me start with the very last because in Brazil, there's actually a very a student of mine that has done a similar work with the Brazilian post-electoral survey. And indeed, you're perfectly right. In Brazil, and we've been doing that with India, with Abhijit Banerjee recently also, you have a completely different pattern. If anything, this is the opposite. You have the emergence of a class-based political conflict, in particular in Brazil, after, you know, between 1992 and today. You can see how the Workers' Party has become was more urban and less lower class at the beginning of the 90s. And if anything, over time, after they've been in power, they've become more, you know, lower education, lower income, lower wealth. And so it's you know, going beyond the West is also a way to see that the what looks like a collapse of a class-based conflict may not be general at all to other settings, and in particular, India is also, I mean, it's a different story, but you have, if anything, you have the emergence of a class-based / caste-based political conflict between the gap between the BJP and the Congress electorate has increased a lot over time. So typically, the upper caste used to vote Congress, and they have completely escaped, and they are entirely BJP today. So you have very, very different pattern once you move beyond the West. Okay, so, well, first of all, let me, you know, say the thanks a lot for all the questions. I'm really, you know, I want to say, you know, this particular paper is doing something very limited, which is to establish this fact, basically, which is this reversal of the education cleavage, which several of you have said is the most interesting fact. Well, that's good, because I agree that this is, you know, this is all I am doing in this paper. And all the other questions, you know, I will really, it's very useful for me to have all these interesting questions, because again, I'm using this material in a book which is much broader than just this material.
typically looking much more at the supply side and the policy side of what the different parties are doing. So this is, you know, I will do my best to answer as well as I can these questions, and which this paper does not address properly. That's for sure. So there was a number of questions which I want to take. Well, there was a general question about participation. So I should really have said that during the presentation, but I have looked at the results on the evolution of turnout throughout this period. And so, of course, what you find is that you have a big decline in turnout pretty much in all three countries, except maybe presidential election in France, but yeah, legislative election, you also have the decline in turnout in France. Now, what's interesting is that in all three countries, the collapse of turnout has been overwhelmingly among the lower education, lower income, lower wealth groups. So if you take the top education, top wealth, top income, you don't have any collapse in turnout. And to me, well, Martial asked about this. To me, this is really the natural interpretation, is that, you know, this rise of this multiple elite cleavage implied that, you know, people who are in neither of the elite have felt left behind and have stayed home. And so I think this amplifies this result. This in itself, this cannot explain the reversal of the education cleavage, because you still have people from different education level who are still voting. You know, it's not only people with PhD who vote. But I think this complements the evolution. So this, so which brings me to the question about the notion of cleavage, the link with Lipset Rokan. So maybe let me. I didn't have time to talk about this, but let me show maybe one or two slides where. Right. So, you know, the Lipset Rokan, you know, study of cleavage. So let me make first a general point. You know, when I look at deciles of education or deciles of income and deciles of wealth, indeed, conceptually, these are not cleavage. These are all proxy for many other things. And then you have to mobilize. You know, you need class consciousness. You need some parties. You need some platform. So in itself, I agree, these are not cleavage. So what's the point of looking at these deciles of education? The only point is to make comparison over time and across countries, to compare. You know, it's the same thing that, you know, when you measure inequality of income, income of wealth, you cannot compare, you know, working class income with a bourgeois income, because the notion of a bourgeois or working class, you know, may be very useful to mobilize people at a given time in a given society. This is the right language in politics, but this is not the right language as a social scientist who wants to make historical comparison, because these notions, by construction, also because they are so rich and so appealing, they are also specific to a given period, and this is why also they are so rich. But then if you want to make comparison, you cannot use them. Now, you can also decide that we don't want to compare anything, but I think it's useful, you know, to I think, you know, this kind of comparison, you know, I think is useful if you take them for what they, you know, this kind of comparison I think is useful. But indeed, as a proxy, and I very much agree with what Sven said. I mean, by the way, if you could send me your presentation, you know, I want to look more at the data that you've shown us, because I think there's really a lot here which I would like to better understand before I can answer to everything. But I think more or less, I sort of agree. Very much, and I think we agree with, and in particular with what you said about education as a proxy. And indeed, for something I don't talk at all about the paper, about the change in the occupational structure, which I think is completely right and very important. So here it's not in itself a cleavage, but it can be the basis for different for different cleavage. So coming back to Lipset Rokan. So in 1967, you know, Lipset Rokan proposed this famous classification of cleavages, which Martial summarized, you know, with the idea that modern democracies are characterized by two major revolutions, national and industrial, that have generated four main cleavages: center versus periphery, state versus church, agriculture, manufacturing, workers, employers, and others. And, you know, this work that I do is very much building on this political science literature. So what's new in what I'm trying to propose here? Well, first, you know, one problem with Lipset Rokan is that there's no racial ethnic dimension, which is sort of weird because they are writing in 1967, and, you know, Lipset is the pope of US political science and sociology, and somehow racial cleavages.
He wrote it later. He wrote it later in another book.
Yes, but okay, but it's the same. Now, it looks as if, you know, he would like this to belong to the past, and so, I mean, it's more a North European and North European view of cleavages, so
maybe at that time, you know, Rokan was more influential, I don't know, but you don't see at all the racial ethnic dimension, which is weird when you study the party system in the US, but which is also weird today if you look at the European party system. So that certainly, this is missing a lot. Now, this doesn't mean that these other dimensions are not important. The real issue is how all this, you know, the multidimensional differences, you know, in occupational sectors, you know, they are even more granular than the dimensions I'm referring to here. You know, these big dimensions, you know, income, wealth, education, income, wealth, you know, they are not the only dimensions that matter. Of course, you have all these other dimensions, center, periphery, sometimes regionalist identity. You mentioned the Muslim identity. I mean, of course, the Muslim identity in itself is extremely complex, and the different people who describe themselves as Muslim in the survey, you know, it can mean very different things for them. So why do I look at them? Well, here it's very pragmatic. Is that, you know, this is the only variable that I have starting in the 1960s and 70s that are related in one way to migration. Now they are related to migration in a complicated way, because you can have, of course, the same North African origin and don't feel at all Muslim. So that's why for the elections where I can make the difference, you know, I look at the country of birth of grandparents separately from the religion, and I show that there are different effects, and that the reported religion has an additional effect to the country of birth, which actually makes them even more left in their voting attitude, which probably is related to the perception that there's a lot of hostility towards their religion with other political parties, or at least that looks like a reasonable interpretation. Now, here, you know, I'm using that, again, it's a proxy for many other things, but this is what we observe in our survey, and this is where we can make make comparison. So, you know, as compared to Lipset-Rokan, I think there's this racial ethnic dimension that is very important. There's a so there's a lot of work, of course, in European political science talking about the rise of the populist right, but typically that do not make the comparison with the US and tend to focus on Europe. So I think this is the other novelty here, if anything, is to try to relate the two. Now, why is this so important? So in the end, you know, what's you know, why do we care about all of this? And you know, there was a question. So let me, you know, I'm going to try to make sure that I did not forget some major question after that. But let me try to answer about the populism and, you know, what do we learn about that? Well, first, let me say, you know, I don't like this word populism a lot. Because I think this is really putting together very different voters, very different feelings, very different belief system. And I think this is more a strategy for people like Macron who want to stay in power with their globalist strategy, to call all of this populism, you know, to summarize. So I think this is, I don't like it. So why is it so? You know, if you look, so here I have this graph in France where I decompose the electorate into four groups. So here I am using two simple questions. Do you think there are too many migrants? And should we redistribute from rich to the poor? Well, the question is phrased in a way that is even more violent, which is good, because you have about 50-50 on both sides. So the question is, should we take from the rich to give to the poor? So it's deliberately violent, so that you have only 50-50. If you look, right. So you have, at the end, you know, you have only 52% who say we should reduce the inequality gap. I think the question is, should we take to the rich to give to the poor? So you have about 50-50 for this question, and you have about 50-50 for the migration question. So remember, in the 1980s, 1990s, it was actually 70-30. So you had 70% in the 80s, 90s who said there were too many migrants. Today it's 50-50. That doesn't mean that it's you know, there's less of a conflict about migration. I think if anything, it means it's more salient, because it means that you really have half of the population who feels that there are not too many migrants, and half who believe there are too many migrants. So you have 50-50 on the migration question, and 50-50 on the rich versus poor question. Now, what's interesting is that these two dimensions, there's basically no correlation at all, in the sense that when you combine these two questions, you get four quarters, and here are the four quarters. So you get almost exactly four quarters
which is not obvious, because when you combine two questions where half-half, you could end up with half-half, you know, if you had perfect correlation, or you could end up with whatever. Here, you really get four quarters. Now, what are these four quarters? Well, you can recognize them, of course, in the first round of the presidential election, which where you have four quarters. So here, I propose to call it this way, you know, internationalist inegalitarian, nativist inegalitarian, nativist egalitarian. You can call it differently if you want. But what I mean is that putting, so who are the populists here? Okay? So according to one analysis, so the populists will be the, at the same time, the internationalist egalitarian, the nativist egalitarians. You know, indeed, if you look at the detailed table, so this is 2017, there are too many migrants in France, 56% on average say yes, but you have 32% for Mélenchon-Hamon, 39% Macron, 62% Fillon, 91% Le Pen. In order to achieve justice, you have 67%. So my bottom line is that, you know, this group is very different from the Le Pen group, and calling them populist, you know, I think it doesn't help the understanding of what's going on. So in the end, you know, the big question, if you think of the governing coalition that we have in Italy right now. Okay, so the Italy is, of course, a very special case because the complete breakdown of the post-war party system started 25 years ago, 30 years ago. So, you know, maybe it's a good, nice thing to look at for, you know, for the next step 20 years from now. But every country is different, but the complete collapse due to the corruption scandal, et cetera, started at that time. By the way, there's an incredible TV series called 1992, if you've not seen it, which just tells you the story of the year 1992 in Italy. Incredible, really incredible, because you have, you see the people who get elected for the Liga, who come back from the war in Iraq, and who are very upset against everybody already. And this was 27 years ago. And I think this is quite interesting, but anyway, this was a parenthesis. So the question, okay, in Italy, for some particular reason, you had the possibility of the populist right and the populist left if you want to unite. Now, they come with very different platforms. You know, Salvini doesn't like migrants at all, but would like to actually cut the tax on the business owners in the north. Whereas the Mouvement 5 Étoiles, Five Star Movement, would like to maybe have actually more tax revenue to pay for transfer to the south and development investment in the south. Now the question is, who is going to win? You know, who is going to have the most appeal? And so here, I think this is where everybody has a responsibility, in particular France and Germany. If you manage to make a policy of redistribution possible, where you help Italy to make the right investment, to have more redistributive taxation on the high wealth group, the high income group, instead of just stealing the tax base from one another all the time, so that in the end they are forced to do a stupid tax exemption, and in the end the only visible cleavage is the migration cleavage, then of course Salvini is going to win, and this is going to turn on the migration side. So, you know, when you have four quarters and when you have two dimensions which are so much, you know, different from one another, and in the case of France, orthogonal to one another, the big question is which dimension is going to become more salient. So, and here, the you know, there's no, it really depends. It depends whether we take, you know, the institutional and the ideological step that make it possible for the redistribution dimension to be, you know, more salient to the people. So, which would mean, you know, more redistributive taxation on high income and high wealth group to finance more investment and education for lower class economic groups. And you need to be very strong on that. You need to be even stronger, more populist, if you want. Than you would be otherwise, because you are fighting against another axis dimension, which you know, the Italian experience is showing can be dominant if you don't do it. So yes, I you know, populist. I think we should be very careful with using this term. Now, many other little points that I missed. Martial talked about unhappy voter. Yeah, I think it's very interesting to use also this kind of subjective question.
The only reason I don't do it is that I focus so much on this long run evolution. You know, I don't have questions about happiness and unhappiness in the 1950s and 60s in the same way. So here I really focus on what I can compare over time. How to interpret the wealth effect? You know, why is wealth so salient? Well, this to me is pretty clear. You know, the conflict about property is the central funding conflict not only capitalism, but politics forever. You know, the ownership of land, and then the ownership of factories, and the ownership of assets. You know, this is what the central political conflict was prior to the French Revolution, the 19th century, the 20th century. You know, this conflict of property is absolutely central, and it's still there. Now, it has been attenuated. So you're right, and what's a bit paradoxical is that you have this increase in wealth inequality, but at the same time, it doesn't make necessarily this conflict over wealth, this cleavage over wealth stronger, because you have so much more happening at the same time that, indeed, I don't think this is really playing much of a role here. Although this can contribute to the feeling of discouragement and economic discouragement, you know, the feeling that there's not much we can do. Well, look, the inequality is increasing, and there were some surveys in the U.S. that were conducted by my colleagues Emmanuel Saez, Stéphanie Stanchella, where you give more information about rising inequality to people, and in fact, this makes them even less. For some group of voters, there were even less intervention by the federal government. You know, as if this sort of reduced their even more their trust in the federal government. You know, as if their reaction was, but what did they do? I mean, these people, they didn't do anything when inequality was rising. So this shows that they are unable to do anything, or that it's impossible to do anything. So this can create discouragement that this economic system cannot be changed. But I don't think in what I'm showing here that there's really anything that is really related. Wealth inequality in itself. Well, first also because it's not huge, in Europe, the increase in wealth inequality. So I don't think this is a major issue. I think the major novelty for Europe is first, well, you have this process of educational expansion and occupational transformation, that is major. The fact that Europe, for the first time, has become more multi-ethnic or multi-religious, which had never been the case before. Compared to the US, you have something that is really new here. I should stop.
I take a few rounds.
Yeah, let me just say that I did not. Nona has so many good questions. You know, I cannot. Bourdieu, 1979. So, what survey was he using in this particular?
I'll send you.
Actually, they were data from the 60s.
It's all the data, so it's interesting for you because it's the same quality.
But probably he was probably using the same survey that I'm using for the 60s.
No.
So it was not a post-electoral survey.
Yeah, it was, and he doesn't use elections. He uses proximity.
Perception.
So it's his own survey on culture.
Okay.
I'll give you all the references.
Ulford, just one word. Ulford index versus odds ratio. Okay, I choose to show top 10% versus bottom 90% because this is what's more striking in the long run evolution. But I also use many other things, top 50 versus bottom 50, broke it by quartile. So you could do it in different ways. I mean, the real difference with Alford is, I agree, it's the same as the Alford index. The only difference, but I think it's important, is that working class status is not comparable over time and across countries. Okay. And that's an important difference, is that here, it's like for income inequality. I the only purpose of using decile is that you can make time comparison. And it's a little detail, but I think it's important if you want to compare societies which sometimes don't want to compare one another to each other, but which we want to compare. That's the only excuse. Otherwise, let me stop that. Social media playing no role in this data because it starts too late from the series.
I think you asked the question. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you for this discussion. Very, very interesting. I'm not sure I understood well, but I think that you who suggested that the general rise of the level of education among the population entailed the rise of inequalities. Is it what you meant? Because if it, that would be completely contrary to the ideology of education, or is it, or do you only mean that education has become a fundamental determinant?
Hi, thank to all of you for your time. I haven't read your paper, so apologies if I'm missing anything that you actually included, but just wanted to make a point about perhaps looking at Central and Eastern Europe, because to what Mr. Rovni was saying, there I think it would be really, really important to look at the vertical and horizontal axis because of the kind of normative value that economic equality has there and hasn't. So, you know, problematic calling it pro-rich and pro-poor, because there I think the difference between looking at how educated people vote on the social, so conservative versus liberal, and on the economic axis would be telling a very different story from the countries that you've included. So simplifying this, and I'm not using any data that I've read, but in countries of Central Europe, I think the educated young kind of group of voters is voting.
Thank you for this thought-provoking words. Is La République en Marche a concrete example of this fusion of multiple elites in the same party?
Thank you very much for the discussion. I think someone has to ask this question, but what about the gilets jaunes? Thank you.
So, Thomas, last words on the four questions?
First question, what's happening with rising education? You know, why does this have this effect? Is this because it leads to rising inequality? So thanks a lot for asking this question, because it makes me realize that I probably did not explain very clearly what I had in mind. So educational expansion, I think, it's not that it's increasing inequality in itself, of course. It could be, you know, if you have sufficient educational expansion, it could reduce inequality. Well, of course, you have to make sure that the jobs are sort of in adequation with the supply of education. But generally speaking, it can certainly be a force to reduce inequality. The only problem is that in terms of political platform, it complicates political platform. What I mean by this is that at the age of primary and secondary education, there was a very simple egalitarian platform for the left, which was, well, you want to get everybody there. You want to get 100% primary education and 100% secondary education. Once you enter the era of higher education, it's more complicated, because you cannot just say, we want to get 100% to PhD. It will take time. So you have to accept the idea of persistent educational stratification. You have to accept the idea that some are going to make it, some are not going to make it. That's very difficult for the left, and this is what the left has not been able to solve. At least that's one of the points I'm trying to make, in the sense that it's complicated, because at the same time, you have to, it forces you to accept inequality in a certain sense, but you have to do everything you can to reduce it and to show that you care also about those who did not succeed. And I think the left has been very bad at doing that in all of these countries, because that's the main point I'm making. So I think one way, how you counter that? Well, first you stop saying that you invest a lot of resources in poor schools when you don't do it. You know, this is a crime. I mean, in France, you know, it has been 30 years that we pretend we put more money in ZEB than other schools, whereas in fact we do exactly the opposite. You know, if you look, given, because you have more contract teachers in ZEB and because you have more experienced teachers in Henri IV, in fact, you know, the average spending per pupil is actually higher in, you know, favored neighborhoods than in lower class neighborhoods. And at, you know, at some point, even if people don't know the statistics exactly, you know, they are fed up to hear things which are not true. And I think, you know, the left in France like the Grande École a lot. You know, it's like this. They like it a lot. And it's good, but you should also like the
you know, people who have not access to this. And so I think this problem of inequality in access to education and educational stratification, you know, is the key. So it's not the rise of education itself. It's certainly not bad, but it has created new challenges in terms of program and platform. And you know, many of the debate, look, I'm going to make another reference to a TV series, so you will think I'm really completely obsessed. But, you know, in Baron Noir, season one, the primary cleavage is about the story of whether people with a professional baccalaureate, so vocational high school degree, have access or not to EUT. These people are being, you know, and in front of them, you have some nice high school students from Henri IV, who are militant with the Socialist Party, and who want to keep the seats for the EUT for people coming from general baccalaureate, and they're going to fight against these people from the suburb who would like to have seats for EUT. Now, this was very well found, I think, by the people who did the scenario of this series, in the sense that, look, there's been a huge increase in the number of people finishing high school in France and having professional baccalaureate. The number of seats in EUT, BTS has not increased at all. And so you put everybody up to baccalaureate, but then there's nothing for them after that. And you know, the left has been in power, etc. You know, didn't do anything. So I think it's this is a problem that the rise of education has created and that has not been addressed properly. Sorry for being so long, but this is really important. And I think, you know, when I show you the graph about the complete reversal of the education gradient, this is really the kind of policy issues that I have in mind. And I realize that I did not even say it because maybe I have it so much in mind that I forget. Eastern Europe, you know, I agree. Eastern Europe is a laboratory of, you know, people who have been so depressed with communism or any attempt to redistribute income and wealth that they go directly to the, you know, identity dimension and anti-migrant dimension is in a way because the economic dimensions has generated a lot of skepticism. And so this is a laboratory of lots of things. And it would be very interesting to look more. There's a group of people with whom I'm working who have started to look at the data for Hungary and Poland, but it's still a little bit in the air. And many countries are not being studied. And then, you know, there is some work. La République En Marche, is this a Brahmin left party? Well, I think, you know, this is a party that's trying to unite the high education elite with the high income elite and the high wealth elite. So they are trying to do the new unification of the elite in one party. And to some extent, they could and they have started to break the multi-polling system and bringing the high income and high wealth group voting for them together with high education. And whether they are going to succeed is still very much open. And I think it depends on the strength of the redistributive conflict. So I think if the strength of the redistributive conflict, and so the possibility, for instance, to conduct redistributive policies at the European and French level, then this attempt might not succeed. Now, if people are convinced that redistribution is just impossible, you know, take the extreme case that I mentioned at the beginning where you assume that vertical redistribution is just impossible because anybody that is taxed above average can, you know, escape and put his income, you know, at zero cost in Switzerland and there's just nothing you can do. And the only thing you can do is to control the border and enter the territory. That, you know, indeed the globalist versus nativist conflict will be there for a long time. If this is the only thing you can fight about, then what do you want else to happen? But I think it's not given because these dimensions of political conflict are socially and historically constructed and are not just given. They don't come from the sky just because globalization is there. They are constructed by you know, the kind of international system and arrangement and treaties and lots of things. And so I'm going to stop there. Gilets jaunes is the reverse side of La République En Marche. So it could, Gilets jaunes, you have, of course, very different people. You know, I think it's stupid to say that it's only the populist right or populist left. You know, you have very different people. It's, you know, my mother in Indre-et-Loire, which is a retired primary school teacher from Indre-et-Loire, has her gilet jaune in her car, and you know, she's not a populist right. And so, you know, you clearly have different people. And so the question is, on which side this is going to this is going to go, and this brings us a little bit to the discussion about the Italian coalition, where in a very strange way you have the sort of two sides, and you don't know exactly where it's going to go. So I'm going to stop there. Just I should all ask you to sign the manifesto for the democratization of Europe, which is a very interesting manifesto, where we propose a way to have more redistributive taxation in Europe. So this is directly related to this. This is exactly the same thing. So if you like the paper, you should sign the manifesto right away. We have more than 100,000 people who have signed it across Europe in the past 4 weeks, which, for a manifesto that's based on a new treaty for Europe, you know, it's not so obvious. This is less than the 1 million signatures that the Gilets jaunes got. But we got quite a bit less of publicity. And so please join us.
Thank you.